everybody. Welcome to Let's Talk Racing. Got Al Pearce and myself getting ready to talk to Eric McClure. How you doing tonight, Eric?
I'm doing good. How about you guys?
Staying warm. How about you?
Well, we're trying to stay warm. Just settled in here on top of the hill. Got a little basketball coming on and just getting ready for the evening.
My goodness. Are you up over in the mountains right now?
We are Southwest Virginia, at the base of a mountain, and you know, live right before you start up the mountain. So a really nice area, except when it gets icy, which we have today. So you know, a nice area to be from.
So who's on TV tonight?
Virginia.
Oh, NC State, Virginia.
It is. I'm a big Virginia guy.
Oh, I know. I know.
Enjoying their success, and we can't. You can't take it for granted, so we've got the recorder going and gonna watch and probably worry about it more than they do.
They can probably beat State. They also play Louisville this week. Who else do they play this week?
They play Notre Dame.
Oh, Notre Dame. Yeah. Notre Dame.
So, you know, it's a brutal conference, so every game is challenging and it makes it a lot of fun. You know, fortunately, they're competitive, and we've waited a long time to enjoy this kind of success. So hopefully they can continue.
Well, Notre Dame won at Carolina the other night, so I'm sure your guys will have their hands full when they play Notre Dame later in the week. But that's not why we're talking to you. I mean, basketball is fun, but it's getting on toward race season. Tell us about your new deal.
Oh, well, it's an exciting time for us. We just announced that we would be moving to JGL Racing in the 24 car for 2015 and beginning our 10th season with Hefty and Reynolds Wrap. So it's an exciting time on a lot of fronts, and certainly we don't have much time before the season starts, and we're all getting a little bit antsy, but the news is exciting for all of us, and we're ready to get started.
Was it a difficult decision, Eric, to change teams? I mean, you've been where you've been for quite a while. Was it difficult to just pick up for the 1st of January and make a major move like that?
Well, change is never easy, whether it's in your personal life or professional life, and this is no different. In our case, I've seen this happen through my family's involvement in racing, and we were at TriStar for 4 years and had a great relationship with the Smith family and that team, and you know, obviously our career highlights came during that time. So there is always a spot of affection for that type of situation. You know, everything that I went through personally and physically, you know, they were right there. At the same time, though, we're always in a business, and that's what we can't lose sight of. And you know, our job as a group is to present the best opportunity for our partners to choose from. And throughout this process, it was very difficult. As needs changed both on our ends and certainly with the team that we were with, and the realization was that something was going to change, and returning to that program was an option. Moving to the program where we were at was an option, and there were many options on the table. New teams, existing teams, whether I would drive, whether I would not drive. You know, we worked through that process and put it in our partners' hands to find what made the most sense for them with their program, both on the racetrack and off the racetrack. That's our first priority. But when you've been somewhere as long as we were, and you develop those relationships, it's always challenging, and there's always the risk that you can't look past the business side of it or past the friendship side of it. And that was the most challenging part for me. But at the same time, our partners want the best program they can have, and I felt like the best opportunity Eric McClure had to improve on the racetrack was to move over to this organization, and that was a priority for JGL, and we love what they're trying to do and the way they make us feel, and sometimes change of scenery is good, and we're going to give it our best effort, but we'll always have a soft spot for TriStar.
Yeah. Eric, you mentioned that you've been through some difficult times both professionally and personally. Our viewers and listeners may not realize that you and your family were basically homeless ever so briefly after a tornado wiped through your area maybe 3 years ago, maybe four, is that correct?
Yes, 2011.
Yeah, I mean, you guys had to pick up from scratch and start over. That was obviously a very difficult personal time for you and your family. And then you were hurt badly at Talladega, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
So that set you back a good bit. I know you're a man of strong faith. We've talked about that before. Did you ever look back on those two moments and wonder, you know, what's going on here? Why is this happening to me? I try to live a good life. I've got a wonderful wife. All girls, I understand, your family. Five girls. Do you ever kind of wonder why you, and you ever get any answers like that?
Well, you know, that's a good question. And obviously, you know, we're human beings. So you do have those thoughts at times or things pop into your head. And sometimes, you know, you just have to, you know, have to look at it a little bit differently. You know, in our situation, we did have the situation with our home. And, you know, we worked through that process and ended up repairing our home, but moving. And, you know, we were without a place living with family for almost 9 months. And that was a challenge. Well, shortly after we got there to our home, then I became ill with the Epstein-Barr virus. And
forgot about that. Yeah, okay.
Here in the accident at Talladega, and obviously the treatment and subsequent fallout from that led to kidney failure. And it seems like it's been one thing after another for us. And during that time, it's hard not to get discouraged. And it's hard not to look at the situation and say, why me and why this? And is this really the way it's supposed to be? But in our situation, where I'm at right now, and there's certainly a lot more in depth to that entire process that, that we'll keep private. But our family right now is as strong as we've ever been, both, you know, at home and as we, you know, we take these steps in motorsports as a family to determine, you know, not just what's best for me, but what's best for our whole group. And as we've looked back, you know, during the last few months and had to make that decision of do we push to continue as a driver? Do we recommend them going to another program, you know, and us staying in the management side? You know, all of that, brought us into a discussion as a family, and we were able to look back on the last, you know, 3.5 years and see exactly where God brought us, exactly, why that maybe we didn't think it was necessary, but we see what has happened, and we see where we're at now and how that experience and those challenges helped shape what we are today and, our attitudes in life and our perception and perspective when we look at the racing season. It certainly changed the way we view things. And, you don't want to have to go through that. You don't want anyone else to have to go through a situation like that. But, the only downside is as we battled through that, I would have liked the opportunity to have been in the situation we were in and have a full season with no injury, no illness, not having to balance chaos in your life and still go to the racetrack. And, when things were good, and that spilled over onto the racetrack. So we're excited about where we are now, in our personal lives, and hopefully this is the end of the valley. But as you go through that, you realize that, you know what, we still have each other. Things could be all a lot worse, and there's always somebody that's battling the same challenges or worse challenges, and it makes you empathize more that, there are greater things than what you do for a living. So, it's really helped shape us as a family and how we teach our girls and the way we live our lives. And our faith is strong, and we know that we weren't going through it alone. And whatever life will throw at us down the road, he'll be right there with us as well.
Now, when you go to Daytona next in a couple, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, thereabouts, you will be on the racetrack with a brand new team for the first time. no testing, no way to get acclimated to each other except by actual being there. Eric, have y'all sat down with a little game plan that, okay, the first day we want to do this, the second practice session we want to do that? Have you got it mapped out pretty carefully, or are you just kind of taking it as it comes?
Well, at this point, we haven't really discussed a plan. Obviously, with the new qualifying changes, you know, and particularly at the speedways, we don't know how strategies are going to play, and we don't know what the goal is. But at this point, you know, at our race team, you know, they're full speed ahead with two race teams and bringing people in and continuing to push forward. And I'll be honest with you, I love restricted plate racing. I think Daytona is one of the greatest places that a person could ever dream about the opportunity to compete, and we've had the opportunity to do that. And, you know, as a veteran, you know, I'm fond of telling people that the inside of the cars all look the same. And I'm at the point in my career, I told Jay Guy just yesterday, our new crew chief, you do whatever you want to do, and when we get there, you tell me what to do, and that's what we'll do. And we're going to place that trust in them. And I would imagine as you know, Daytona and Speed Weeks approach, we'll, as a team, they'll have a little bit better idea of what they want to do, you know, with practice and with qualifying and things like that. Is, you know, this year the schedule's more condensed, and we don't get on the racetrack till the day before the race. So it's going to make for a lot of excitement, no doubt. But at this point, just for me, I'm just looking at the excitement or the opportunity to be, you know, to be a building block in a team, and you know, where there's only two cars rather than, you know, four, five, six cars, and you know, trying to, you know, stay relevant in that type of an organization. So I'm excited about the commitment that this team has made for me, the people they're bringing in, and, you know, we'll let those guys make those decisions. And, you know, I have a hard enough time as it is, you know, with as chaotic as our lives are and everything else. I figure that's one less thing for me to worry about. We'll let them make those decisions.
So you don't get on the racetrack until Friday? I didn't realize that. I thought maybe y'all might have a Wednesday or a Thursday practice before you actually qualified on Friday. But so it's a Friday Saturday show for you guys.
It really is. This is the first year that you know, a Wednesday and Thursday practice hasn't been the case. And you know, we saw some efforts by NASCAR throughout the course of last year, particularly at the end, to try new procedures to try to condense the weekend, which originally was the reason all of our qualifying was impounded, you know, since 2005, was to try to save the teams an extra day, to try to save teams, you know, like a JGL or a TriStar, you know, money. And ultimately, that wasn't the case. And now you see a real dedicated effort for them to protect, you know, the structure of the series and the structure of the majority of teams that support the series. So you're going to see a lot of, you know, two-day on-track weekends this year, I believe, from what we understand. And, you know, whatever the case is, we don't have any control over that. But I think, you know, from the business side of things, knowing exactly what the parameters of our programs are and what guys like James Whitener and Greg Mixon from JGL are trying to do, it makes a lot of sense. And, you know, I like Florida, I like Daytona. I wish we could spread it out for 2 weeks, but unfortunately that's not the case, and they're going to condense it pretty tight. But, you know, it'll put a greater importance on coming off the racetrack prepared, or coming off the hauler prepared before you get on the racetrack. So we're looking forward to that, and you know, we're in the same boat as everyone else. We'll see how it plays out.
Well, yeah, but you're with a new team, though. You would, I mean, given your druthers, you'd rather have way more practice than just one day. You know, I can see a two-day program at a place called Richmond, a place like Richmond or Martinsville, maybe even Dover, but it just doesn't seem like a two-day program would work at Daytona, being the first race of the year, knowing how many new teams are going to be there. It just seems like somebody at NASCAR is a little bit short-sighted on this one, but they didn't get rich by making bad decisions, so I guess they know what they're doing.
Well, they do, and you know, they have a way of making things work, which ultimately benefits them and us as well too. And you make valid points with that question and that statement. At the same time, one thing that you know, you guys may know, the average person doesn't know, the driver is getting less and less important on the racetrack. And at Daytona and Talladega, you know, there's a common phrase of, you know, what you have is what you have. And the type of racing is conducive to that type of statement. You know, in being with new people and new race teams, it's, you know, you want to have that chemistry. You want to start working with your team, and obviously not being able to test is you know, something that doesn't work in our favor. Having said that, you know, Jay Guy's a veteran. These employees and race team members are veterans. The management, you know, I've been around 9 years, and, you know, certainly that's a strong track for me. At the same time, we hope to have that chemistry. We'll work on that during the off season. You know, we both look at it, you know, certainly from my seat, a little bit of a chip on my shoulder wanting to go and run well and feel like, you know, even at this age, you know, you still always feel every day like you have to prove something. And I enjoy that challenge and that feeling, but, you know, it's something everyone's going to have to adapt to, and I feel like, how many, you know, with the number of races I've had in this series, with the number of races that Jay Guy and these guys have had, you know, we don't feel like we'll be that far behind as far as that part of the relationship. You know, if the cars are good, we'll run well, and we'll learn each other, you know, in the language and communication, we'll improve from there. You know, I've had different crew chiefs a lot. I've had different personnel every year to get used to. But at the same time, if you look at a team, you know, where we were at last year and the number of drivers that came in and out of that organization, and it didn't help or hinder the overall performance. So as long as you can meet your goals and set those goals, you know, you feel like your experience will help. But at the same time, it does put a sense of urgency, as you might say, for working with a new team and gelling maybe a little bit more quickly than you would have had to in the past. So we'll see how it works out.
Okay.
At the end of the day, we'll have to make the best of it.
All right. Well, listen, good luck to you. Go watch the Cavaliers. Let me ask you just a yes or no question, and then you can go. When you get to Daytona in February, will the Cavaliers still be undefeated, yes or no? We may have lost him.
My heart says yes. My head says probably not. Hey, a lot of parity.
I know.
Almost went down last night. But listen.
Yeah, but if you can win in double overtime at Miami, you must be doing something right. Eric, thanks so much. Good luck to you. Good luck to your Cavaliers. I will not mention the Tech UVA football game. It disappointed me also, quite frankly. But anyway, we will see you at the beach in about a month or so.
You had to bring that up. I really appreciate that. You guys have a great
night. Talk to you later, Eric.
Take care. Thanks so much.
Bye. We have Dale Stetz on the line. How you doing, Dale?
I'm doing good, guys. How are you guys doing tonight?
All right. Why don't you go ahead and give us a little bit of background in the racing world here about yourself?
Well, I started pretty much like a lot of guys. We started in the go-kart ranks back in 1982. Started at the age of 9 and pretty much stayed in the go-karts. We went ahead and we've done some third late model and some super truck stuff, and coming up through the go-kart ranks, I got into doing fabrication work. We actually started a manufacturing company in 99 and manufactured go-kart race car chassis, and we've been doing that for the last 16 years and enjoying racing.
Now, you've got the mini cups that you're building now and trying to help revive that series.
Yeah, we We've always played around with the mini cups for about the last 10 years. I've always been involved with the mini cups, and it kind of fell apart over the last several years. The different series and people running them, they went different directions, and the mini cups now, what our goal is, probably about 8 months ago, I started Mini Cup USA. And really just started it as a Facebook page. Wanted a place to where people can go on there and talk about mini cups, share information, where they're racing, help each other out. And we started that. You know, today we're a little over 500 members, and it's growing every day. But we actually put on a race back in October, and we had a good turnout, and we had a lot of response to it. And last year, we seen where a lot of people have interest in the mini cups. So one of our announcements we wanted to do tonight, we actually have built a new chassis that we're going to debut in a few weeks, to where we can try to get more people into the mini cups at affordable price. A lot of the problems with the mini cups now are the racetracks, the asphalt tracks, really don't run our cars. Some of them, it's due to insurance purposes. And coming from a go-kart background with the supply of go-kart tracks and the response we got from the carters, we designed a chassis, and we want to be able to turn this chassis out to the racers at a inexpensive price to where they can get into these mini cups. They're basically going to look like miniature dirt late models at a price close to what they can race champ carts for.
Now, you hear the term mini cup. What is that telling people about what the size of the car, or what is the difference between that and the other things that you see out there?
Well, with the mini cups, they are they're half-scale versions of race cars. A full cage car, racing seat, racing belts, disc brakes. We're running on slick racing tires. You're in a full enclosed cockpit, just as you are in a full-size race car.
What size engine does this thing have in it?
Well, that's one of the things that we're doing. We're basing ours on a Honda GX390 single piston overhead valve motor. The motor that we're doing is coming with the car. We're trying to do it to keep costs down in the racing. We want to be able to, like I said, pretty much offer this to people where they can get into it at a real fair price.
What's the estimated top speed on the car once you've got it out there running?
Right now, I mean, we're going to do some asphalt races too, depending on your size of your track. I mean, these cars can go anywhere from, on the average tracks we run, 50 to 60 miles an hour on the dirt. You can, on the bigger tracks, you're 60 to 80 miles an hour.
Okay. Now, you were telling me earlier that you've had them out there doing a little bit of dirt racing here just recently?
We did. In October, we put on a race up at Carolina 120, and we offered one of the things that we like to do with the races that we're going to put on is just not do a normal payout. We had some great sponsors team up with us, Clements Racing Products and Parsons Racing Supply and Affordable Bender, and they teamed up with us, and we had stuff to give away, gift certificates and the engines, and you know, we didn't want to do the typical you come race and pay first, second, third place, and you know, we did trophies, we had custom made trophies, and that's one of the things that we want to offer with our racing and the races that we're going to put on.
Now, are y'all trying to target mostly the kart tracks? Or are you trying to, I mean, what area are y'all trying to target now with the series?
With this series, I mean, we've got a lot of interest in the Midwest with people. My partner in this, Chuck Holcomb, with Holcomb's House of Power, he's going to be doing the engines for these cars. And between the two of us, we both have a real long karting history, and we don't want to target just the karters, but with the availability of the kart tracks in the Carolinas, and from Tennessee, Virginia, all the way down to Florida, with the kart tracks available, we have more opportunities to go race and more places to run.
Okay. Now, you were talking about a website. What's the website that people can go to find out a lot of the stuff about what's going on?
We have a Facebook page. That's mainly where we do all of our stuff, but it's Mini Cup USA on Facebook. They can come over there. It's actually a closed group. We're looking at opening it up to anybody. We pretty much just did it as a closed group to kind of a lot of the spam, and we want to keep it as a clean website, family orientated. We want to try to get as many kids involved in this as we can. You know, the tracks that we've been to and the races that we have put on, kids see these cars, and when we did the race at 120, we had a car up there just for a display. It was actually our asphalt car, but we could keep the kids out of it all night. I mean, they're more than welcome to it, but I mean, they were non-constantly, and you know, it brings the parents over, and it strikes up the conversation with the cars. So we were really surprised. You know, something that I actually started as a Facebook page to help all the Mini Cup racers out ended up turning into a little bit bigger deal.
So if somebody wanted to come visit you or the shop, where are you guys located at?
We are actually located in upstate South Carolina, right outside of Greenville.
Where? Exactly.
Where? You got an address?
We're actually in Wearshoals, South Carolina. It's a small town. We're actually located on Highway 25. Our physical address is 17606 Highway 25. Any information, people can call us at the shop at 843-602-8350.
Good deal.
Dale, is that on the east side or the west side of Interstate 85? You say it's near Greenville. I know the area pretty well.
Okay. We are actually located south, I guess it would be southwest of 85. We're in between Greenville and Greenwood.
Okay. Anywhere near Clinton?
Clinton's just a little bit further south. I think Clinton's probably about 25 miles from me.
Yeah, I went to college there many years ago. So I know the area. I know Greenwood pretty well. I know Due West. I know Lawrence. I know Easley. I got a lot of buddies at Easley and Greenville and down that way. So I know pretty much about where you are now. That gives me some idea of where you're located.
Yeah, we're located just in a small town.
Yeah, Wearshoals. I know it. Yeah, I had classmates from there. Where is the farthest north you guys have brought cars to race? You mentioned you raced in North Carolina last year. Have you been up from Virginia up this way at all?
We've got several guys from Virginia on our Facebook page. Like I said, we pretty much just started the Mini Cup USA about 8 months ago, and it's taken off so big, within just under a year. But with our cars, I mean, we've raced the asphalt cars up in Virginia, it's been a couple of years ago for me personally that we went and raced. But, you know, with the guys that are involved with me, they raced in Concord. We've got some guys down in Dillon, South Carolina. They race down there. But with our series, what we're trying to do is bring everybody together under one set of common rules to where if the guys from Virginia want to race one of our Mini Cup USA races, that they can come race with us with minimal changes, minimal expense with our rule package. Our modified class on the dirt is going to be pretty much open as long as it's based on the 390 motor. We have our stock rules posted on our Facebook page that, you know, if the guys from up north want to come down and race, they can come with minimum change. It might be just a carburetor, things like that. So we're trying to get it to where it other people can come and try to regroup everybody again. But, you know, we do have the guys up in Virginia. We've got guys out in the Midwest, Utah, Colorado, a lot of people on the Facebook page that give a lot of input, share information, and try to help everybody out.
Your group might enjoy coming to Langley Speedway up in Hampton, up here. Langley's a little bit under a fourth of a mile flat. Really, really nice facility. You guys might think at some point, maybe not this year, but maybe in the future, of contacting the folks at Langley and racing up here.
Yeah, it's been several years ago that I didn't go up there for a Mini Cup race. We went up there for a truck race. And I know the guys up in Virginia with Langley and a couple of the other tracks. What our plan is for this year, you know, once we're getting this chassis out, it's primarily going to be a dirt chassis. It's going to be a rigid car. With our series, I mean, we're open to rigid and suspended cars running together. I know some places don't like to do that, but that's one of the things that we wanted to do to bring everybody together. Try to get Mini Cup racing back to where it was back in the 90s.
Cool.
Last question for you. I know you got to go back to work. When is your season open? When is the first event? Where will the first event be? Give us some idea of where people can come and see y'all to kind of get their early season racing fix.
We've got some races. We haven't had them locked down right now. We're working on putting. This year we're going to do a couple big races. We want to get everything going and lined up, and probably next year we'll do a full schedule. But we plan on having a couple dirt races at Patriot Speedway. It's located up near Blacksburg, right off of 85. It used to be called Iron City Cartway. We're going to do a race there. Probably around the 1st of March is what we're planning. But we have some other big races planned this year. We're just waiting to hear back from the track owners. We haven't had a definite answer from them, so we're kind of waiting on that before we announce those.
Cool.
Okay. So now when you just mentioned Blacksburg, you mean Blacksburg, South Carolina?
Yes.
Because there's a Blacksburg, Virginia, which folks know about. So, but yeah, I know we're Black. That, at the bottom of that steep hill on 85 at Blacksburg, I know it well. Yeah.
Yeah. There's
not far from Spartan, not far from Green, from Gaffney and Spartanburg, that area.
No, and it's kind of a good location. It gives everybody, you know, from North Carolina and all the other areas. It's pretty easy access, right on 85.
Yeah, I know it well.
Cool. All right, Dale, we'll go ahead and let you get out of here, get back to work, and we'll be talking back more with you later on.
That sounds good. Well, thank you, guys, and appreciate being on the show.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye. How you doing tonight, Roger?
What?
Yeah, we got Roger Carter on the line. You got Al Pearce and myself here getting ready to field all the stuff we're going to throw at you. Hey, how's your racing season looking so far?
Oh, it's looking good. We're getting everything ready for Daytona. We're bringing four cars to race at Daytona and going to test next week, and we think we've got pretty good cars to go test with and go back and race with. So we're pretty happy with that, where we're at right now.
Now, where are you guys located out of?
We're in Asheboro, North Carolina. We actually, our shop is, it's really considered Asheboro. We're in Seagrove, a little town of Seagrove, not too far out of Asheboro.
Okay.
Jack Ingram country.
Yeah, we're in the country.
But I mean, that's where Jack Ingram, I mean, Sam Ard. I said Jack Ingram, I meant Sam Ard. That's yeah. Sam Ard country, yeah, okay.
You're absolutely right.
Give some of the listeners out there some of the background about how you got into racing.
I got into racing when I was actually in high school. Me and a friend of mine built our first street stock car, and Coach Pete Alonso can help us out a little bit with it, getting it straightened out when we were in high school, and we've been going hard at it pretty ever since. So I partnered up with Dick Bear in the early 90s, and you know, I moved down south and did some stuff in cup racing and and all the series over the years. I've owned the truck team and co-owned the cup team and nationwide deal, and ARC has always been my favorite place to be because they're more of a family organization that looks after us, and they've been good to me. So we ran our first ARCA race in 1994, and I've been pretty pretty content to stay with them. And as it, I get a little bit older, if I really plan on just trying to finish out my racing days in ARCA, maybe run a few truck deals and nationwide deals if they arise. But that's pretty much how I got started. I built this street stock car, and I met Dick Bear, and we struck up a good friendship, and that's kind of what got me into the racing down south. And I actually at one point purchased a couple days of Thunder cars that were used in a movie for my dealership in Michigan, and met Papa Joe and kind of got a little network down here, and I ended up moving down here. So that's kind of how it all developed.
Now, y'all went and did some testing in December too, didn't you?
Yes, we went and tested in December. Very happy with my my Dodge cars. I think that they're the best they've ever been. We've been working on one for several years to get their aerodynamic package right on it, and I think it's real good. Bobby Hamilton Jr. is going to drive that car, and we've got the race package in it now. We're going to go down and test with him, and hopefully it's as good as we think it is. I've got two Toyotas we're taking down. I'd like to give you more information about that. I'm kind of in limbo with those because I'm waiting on the Ilmor motor. From my understanding, they're behind. I spoke to them today, and I don't know where that's going to lead. But I'm definitely running four cars, and whatever the manufacturers may be, but I do have two Toyotas and whatever engine package is in it. I'm not 100% sure yet, but as of today. But I do hope that one of them has the Ilmor deal in it, and go from there. So.
Now, are you going to be driving any of them, or are you going to be playing team owner?
Well, I'm going to have to do the team owner thing for this one. I would love to run Daytona. It's obviously one of my favorite racetracks to run, but with everything that I got going on, I feel like, to give my drivers 100%, I need to step this one out. So I put a sponsorship deal together earlier in the year, and I just kind of combined that with Bobby and Donnie Nuremberger's deal to make it work. So I just needed more funding, so I kind of took the back seat. So.
Now, we were talking earlier to Eric McClure, and he said that the Xfinity race that his people are going to run, they will not get on the racetrack in Daytona until the Friday before. You guys race on Saturday or Sunday of the first weekend?
We race on Saturday the first.
Okay, but you're on track Thursday, I understand.
Yes, we're on track on Thursday. I think it's 4 to 6 is our time on the track.
So y'all get 2 days of practice before running your first race.
Yes.
I'm just curious why NASCAR would not give every series that runs down there more than just one short practice session before their race.
I don't know. And, you know.
But you guys are heading, you know, you're satisfied with your schedule. You got your own track Thursday, your own track Friday, you race Saturday, then you're out of there. So it's not a great financial burden on you for lodging and meals and all. But it just seems like it's a hindrance to the Xfinity teams that don't get any practice until Friday before their Saturday race. Just doesn't seem quite right to me. But
I agree with that. But I mean, I'll just go back to, you know, there's probably NASCAR has a reason for that. You know, track scheduling, I know, is always very tight at Daytona because all the series, from my understanding, they've condensed them down, even including ours. We used to spend almost a whole week there, and I think they started condensing it down because of the, you know, the cost, which, you know, obviously as a team owner, I agree with. I haven't looked at the, you know, NASCAR schedule for any of their series, to be honest with you. But I didn't know they had them down to just running on, you know, Friday and then, you know, racing Saturday. But I do know from everything NASCAR has talked about and what they're doing is the same cost conscious deal. The shorter time we're there, the less time we're on the track, the least amount of money we spend. Me as a car owner, I'm all for the least amount of time on the track as long as your stuff's, you know, right. For us, you know, we have two open test sessions this year. So, I mean, when we go there, our stuff better be right. You know, I don't see where we need a whole lot of practice when we are there. So, you know, they could have cut ours back as far as I'm concerned, because if we don't have a right in two open test sessions, something's wrong. So,
yeah, you're not going to be right. If you don't get it right now, you won't be right. The other question might be, does the ARCA management or the people that run the program, do they listen to owners and drivers when y'all talk about finances and travel and expenses? Because some cup owners say, have told me in my years of covering this stuff, that we talk to NASCAR, they nod their head and they say, yes, we understand. And then when things happen, it's like they weren't even listening to us at all.
Like lip service.
Do the ARCA people listen to you folks and take into their minds what you're trying to get to them?
Well, yes and no.
Okay.
Figures.
On the same category that you're... I love ARCA series, and I'm not down on them in any way, shape, or form, and I'm not afraid to, so it's nothing to do with like NASCAR where they keep you from saying anything. It has nothing to do with that. I think the only thing that I would like to see ARCA do more, and this is the same thing I voiced my opinion to them face-to-face, so I don't have a brain problem saying this here, is I think they do, but they seem to consult the wrong teams to ask about finances and what it takes to be on a budget. I think they're more concerned with the teams that have the bigger budgets to ask them what it takes to cut costs, because their idea of cutting costs and mine are two different things. I run on an extremely smaller budget than probably any of the top 15 teams. And I don't think that they consult enough with teams like myself. Just like when this new engine program, I'll give you a perfect example. The new engine program and the composite body deal that came out. The engine program, I have Toyotas and Dodges. We have numerous Dodge motors that we own. So they come out with a composite body program that doesn't have a Dodge body, because Dodge don't participate no more. So what that means is I can't run my Dodge motors with a composite body. So then they say an optional 396 Fillmore motor, but it's mandatory you have to run the Toyota. They don't make, you can't run because they don't have a small bore motor for the Toyota. There's no motor for the Toyota but the ARCA motor. So I get really jaded when they say it's optional, because nothing is optional for me. It's mandatory ARCA Fillmore motor for my Toyotas, and it's mandatory ARCA Fillmore motor and composite body change, because I can't use my Dodge motors with the new composite body. So in this deal, when they come out with this and they sit down with certain team owners, they sure in the heck didn't sit down with me. So yeah, I'm a little bit, being a multi-car owner, I would think that they would have, but they didn't. And I voiced my opinion about it, because it's been extremely difficult for me when you're talking about $48,000 at the end of the day to put one of these Fillmore motors in. Yes, in the long run, is it probably going to be better for us? I would hope so. I guess time will tell that. But, you know, when I'm forced to do it because I have Toyotas, that's an issue for me.
Yeah.
I wasn't made aware of that, and now I'm at a point where, you know, I don't know if they're going to be ahead of schedule enough to provide me with the motor to race because I wasn't in the financial and in the A-click, I guess you say, to write checks right in the beginning to pay for my motors right when they first come out with this program. So now that I am prepared to pay for mine, they don't have one. So, you know, where does that leave us? So, yeah, there's some frustration there. Is it the series' fault? I'm not going to say that they did anything intentional. It's not that. It's just, you know, they do have a tough balance to try and make everything work for everybody. But, you know, this situation is, I think ARCA racing is built off from, you know, lower budget teams. And I try to voice this all the time because I'm going to be there no matter what. And I can name several other teams that are going to be there no matter what. And, you know, this is a development series, but you get teams that come in and stay over 2-3 years and leave because they use it for what they want and they go on. Guys like me are going to be here. We stay. So I would like to see more attention paid to their roots instead of worrying about who spends the money this year and, you know, who's writing the big checks and catering to that. I would love to see more balance. I would love to see that initiative taken, but, you know, I think it's that way in any series. I mean, it don't matter the late model stock or cup racing or whatever. It seems to be that way across the board. So
it reminds me of when you say that they listen to some people, not others. I was a school teacher very, very briefly years ago, and on PTA night, the parents of kids that you don't need to talk to are always there, and the parents you need to talk to never show up. So I guess in your case, ARCA would do well to come talk to you and get your problems in their head instead of the guy who doesn't really have as many problems as you do. So it's... And I'm sure NASCAR listens to Rick Hendrick and Joe Gibbs more than listens to Tommy Baldwin. So,
absolutely,
it may be the same wherever you go. Unfortunately, but that's the hand you're dealt, and I guess you got to play with what you got.
Well, you know, there's an old saying: either you suck it up or go home. You know.
So, yeah. Oh yeah.
I, you know, I can't sit here and cry about it because it's my prerogative to be here, you know, and do what we do, but. You know, I would love to see, I can name a bunch of teams, and I'm not done on here because, you know, I don't want to put them in that, but I'm a little more outspoken than most. I think most everybody knows that, but I can name several teams here that would love to be in the same, you know, have the same voice that are like me, that race every week and race on a budget and do it for strictly the reason they love racing. And, you know, I'm not knocking the big budget teams because they help me a lot. You know, I get help from them. And I think it's just a combination of everybody. We need them. They need teams like us. They need the one-off race teams. They need all of us. But there just has to be a better balance to communicate with everybody to say, okay, what's it going to take to keep you coming to the race every week where you pay your bills, to keep the guys that are running for a championship, to keep them happy, because, you know, there's just a balance there, and I mean, I just feel like we're missing it. Not just in ARCA, I think we're missing it every series that there is.
You know, people who listen to our program on a regular basis have heard me say for years that I think that anybody who is a good, successful ARCA driver might be as good as or better than any NASCAR driver, because ARCA guys run dirt, you run short track dirt, high bank dirt, you run everything that Cup does, and then plenty of places where separate skills are involved. I would not bet against an ARCA driver being more versatile than any Cup driver you can name, because they have to run at every type of racetrack.
I would agree with that. I think especially now in our series, I think it showed this last season how we just have a lot of great talent in our series right now, and I would agree with that. Nobody's running over each other like we had a few years ago. Everybody respects everybody. You can race side by side, and you know, I'm really impressed with the talent that's in this series, and I think anybody really takes a step back and looks at it and sees how talented these drivers really are. You know, I got some drivers that run for me that I'm just, you know, they're extremely talented. And, you know, it's just like anything else. It's a funding issue. If, you know, I've got some drivers I'd love to put in my car that I can't because they don't have funding. There's races that I'd love to run where I know my long suits are that I can't because of funding at times. And you know, I mean, it's just you know, there's an extreme talent pool of great race car drivers out there now because the sport is so popular and they start so young. And you know, I would agree with you. I think ARCA Series puts out some of the best talented race car drivers there is.
I'd love to see some of the cup guys run a dirt track in a full body stock car one time. I know they run the trucks at Eldora, but I mean, you know, run a half mile dirt track or a mile dirt like ARCA does every now and then, and we'll see what we got. And I bet on the ARCA guys in that situation more often than not.
Well, I always say, you take a guy like myself and people that, you know, some of my drivers that drive for me, and not just in my team, but in a lot of our teams, I always say it all the time. There's been times that we've started on 40-lap old tires and ran the whole race on 40-lap old tires to finish in the top 10. I mean, dial in the top 10, lead lap, and all that stuff with a tire you can't even hardly keep. You know, it's so out of shape, you can hardly drive it. And I say that all the time. I would love to see one of these guys that gets, you know, all these multiple sets of tires that can't run on nothing but new tires. And you know, I agree. I think this series breeds some really good talent for that reason because, you know, the budget's not as big. And you know, you have to run some of the stuff that's down on horsepower. You don't have the tire budget and, you know, the shock budget, the springs and all the stuff that it takes to have a real comfortable driving race cars, because believe me, I've drove, and some of my own stuff, I've drove some wonderful, great race cars of my own, and I've drove some real terrible stuff of my own because of budget reasons. So I know the difference, and, you know, I think that's what makes good race car drivers. And, you know, I don't think just throwing all the money at it and the tires and all the best of everything really grooms great race car drivers. I think being, you know, where you have to drop some of this old stuff like it was the old school, like Kenny Schrader had to do. He started out with driving pure, you know, bottom of the barrel stuff and worked their way up, and a lot of the old-time race car drivers did. And that's what makes excellent race car drivers, in my opinion. I throw all the money at it, give them the best of everything, that's, you know, you got to have talent to drive these things, but it's sure and a heck of a lot easier. I know when I get blessed enough to have a set of new tires, I know what it feels like. It's a whole lot different than driving somebody's barrel of 40 laps off.
Well, listen, we appreciate your time. I know you're probably awfully busy getting ready to go to the beach, but you're probably, about 5 weeks off, 5 weeks off. Good luck to you down there. Hope your cars do well. Mostly, be safe, and we'll have you on during the season, and you can keep us up on how things are going.
Sounds great. I appreciate being on the show, and anytime, I always look forward to it.
All right. Take care. Thanks so much.
All right, take care.
Thanks.
All right, bye-bye. All
right,
let's go eat.
Didn't even get to 8 o'clock.
We were pretty close.
Yeah, I know. But he's got a nice little lineup of drivers here. And did your glasses? Josh Reeves, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Donnie Neuenberger, Ronnie Osmer, and these two newbies. I know Cassie, so I meant to ask him how she was doing, if she's actually going to be running the race or not.
All right. Go down some again. I know Bobby Hamilton. I know him. Josh Reeves, I don't know.
He's run some nationwide races, if I remember correctly.
All right.
But anywho.
So how many cars does he take? He was taking 2 cars today?
Four.
Four.
4 cars.
Okay.
Gonna get a bunch of people out there.
I hope so.
All right. Well, we'll catch everybody next time on Let's Talk Racing.
We'll be back next week.
Food time.